Good evening. I'm very excited to be here tonight in San Francisco for the first time I'm here ever. Thank you. And as you know, the plan is to do one lecture in English and right after that in Hebrew. Those of you who speak both languages, take advantage. You can have a double meal tonight. And Bezrat Hashem, I brought you a lot of free CDs, as you can see by the water there. And also I brought a bunch of my books. It just came out, my new book. The CDs are for free. You can also purchase books for $20 each. And also I have USBs with all my lectures on it, 1,000 hours on it. You can plug it in a car, $20 also. The CDs are all free. We're moving now into the new era that some of the cars don't have CDs. We have to make USBs. Each USB is like almost 40 CDs. Each CD, 30 hours of lecture. So it's enough for over a year. Speaking about CDs, you have to know that the goal of a life of a Jew to be connected to Hashem is to be connected every day to Torah. Just like a person that has an infection and he needs to receive every day antibiotic, if he will take one day and then rest for 2 days, and then take one day and then rest for 3 days, it's not going to do so well. In the way Hashem designed the world, that every person has yetzer hara, strong evil inclination. And the strong evil inclination is orchestrated by an angel called the Satan. I'm sure you heard about him more than once in your life. And this Satan is actually sending his soldiers to do his will in the world and to convince people to make sins. How a person will be able to protect himself from making sins? How is it possible? The answer is by being connected to Torah. There's nothing that can help a person to overcome his desires and evil inclination and bad midos, bad traits, more than being connected to Torah. And that's, by the way, the key, most important thing in the life of a person. And that's why, by the way, that the Satan will do everything he can to prevent a person from learning Torah daily. Here and there, to come to lectures, no big deal. But if he will be connected every day seriously to Torah, in a month or two, or maximum three, he's going to become a real Ben Torah. The Torah is very addictive. The more you learn, the more you fall in love with it. Ta'amu ruki tov Hashem. Pikudei Hashem yesharim mesamchei lev. So there are few sentences, few verses in the Torah that says that Pikudei Hashem mesamchim makes the honest, the straight, and they make a person happy. The Torah makes a person happy. You can see there are people who take today medication, anti-depression, all kinds of drugs. It makes a person temporarily be relieved from his misery. But then just when the medicine expires, the misery comes right back. But the Torah, if a person goes into a track of being connected to Torah, after a certain period of time, you begin to see wonders. In 24 years that I deal with the public, Baruch Hashem, I had the merit to bring many, many hundreds of boys, Israeli boys, and some Americans, to the yeshiva. They were secular people. They started to become more observant, and I saw an opportunity. You know, come try to learn in the yeshiva for a month, and then many people came to the yeshiva over the years, and you see wonders. Within 3 months, from the minute they enter the yeshiva and learn from morning to night, after 3 months, you do not see anything in this person that he had 3 months ago. Nothing. It's like a whole different human being. You don't recognize the person. All of a sudden, he dressed different. His haircut is different. His beard is different. The way he speaks is different. His emunah, his faith is different. His generosity is different. His hard-working effort is totally different. This is a person who never woke up before 11 a.m. All of a sudden, 7 o'clock, he's with a talit and a tefillin in yeshiva after mikveh. Meaning at 6, he was up already. You cannot recognize the person. You say there's no place in the world that you can take a person that had so many negative things about him, and 3 months later you don't recognize it. Mamash, a whole different person. Much less anger, much less jealousy, much more emuna in Hashem, much more devotion. And the most important thing, the more you get into the Torah, the greater and the more you love it. It's unbelievable. And I'm telling you from experience. You don't need to count on my experience, even though it says En Chacham Ela Kebal Nisayon. When I tell you, believe me because I have experience, or believe me because the Torah promised, the answer is you have to believe me because the Torah say it, not me. But as on top of it, I can add it that I can confirm from reality that that's how it works. So now, you're living in a place, San Francisco. It's not exactly Yerushalayim. Okay? So it's not exactly Yerushalayim. In today's world, there's a lot of tests of what's going on here. The kind of people that lives here, the kind of tradition that goes on around here, the way the people dress, their habits, there are all kinds of things that they do. Many of the things that the people around us here, they do, it's darkness, spiritual darkness. It's sometimes abomination, sometimes rebelling against Hashem, sometimes it's idol worshipping. The atmosphere, in the Lashon HaKodesh, the word atmosphere called avira. Air that you breathe, it's avir. Atmosphere, avira, that it's very interesting. In Lashon HaKodesh, the air that you breathe and the atmosphere that you live in is the same word. Meaning the air that you breathe affecting your spirituality. Just because you live among certain people. So if you move to live in a place when everyone is Yirei Shamayim, people love Torah, love Hashem, there's lots of modesty, automatically it affects you, even if you do basically nothing. Just being around this kind of people, pushing you higher and higher with not that much of an effort. When you live in society that decided to make rules that are basically all against the creator of the world, the rules, there's two kinds of rebelling against Hashem. Sometimes a person rebels against Hashem, not because he doesn't believe in Him. Not because he does not believe in the Torah. Not because he does not believe there is such a thing, reward and punishment. Not because he does not believe there's such a thing, afterlife, Olam Haba, that we will inherit Olam Haba one day based on the good things that we're going to do. Not because of that. Purely, only because of personal desires. He comes and say to you, Rabbi, believe me, I love Hashem just as much as you do. And you know what? When I listen to Torah, I enjoy just as much as you enjoy. And I wish, sometimes I cry with myself, I wish I could be better. But what do you want? Look how I grew up, look how I live, look at my family, it's too late for me, when will I start? My work, the nature of my life, where I live, I have to move, I have to go next to a synagogue, I don't even have a shul next to my house. Just thinking about what a mountain I have to cross takes away all my energy. It's very difficult for me to change. But I do believe in everything. But at the same time, he will break almost every possible rules of the Torah. But not because he's anti-God, not because he does not agree with his rules, not because he doesn't think the Torah is the emet. No. It's called in the Lashon of Chazal, Reshaim leteavon. Teavon means appetite. When you're hungry, you're going to eat something that is not kosher, not because you want to make Hashem angry. Because the desire is too difficult. You didn't eat for a whole day, and now you see the steak, and you say, Hashem, only this time. Please close your eyes. Only this time. I'm hungry, come on, you know, all day I try not to eat, but that, enough is enough, come on, how long you want me to stay hungry? If I don't eat now, I'm going to have to be until tomorrow 10 a.m. without food. It's very difficult. Only this time. Who's to say this fish is not kosher? Maybe it is. I take my risk. Only this time. The meaning is apologizing in his conscience to Hashem for doing what he did. Same thing with a woman, same thing with a lot of other things, same thing with sometimes stealing. A minute later, his conscience is beeping. Hey, look what you just did. And the person feels guilty about what he did, but the desire is too strong. Why the person is keep failing and failing and failing? Again, not because he wants to go against Hashem and getting upset and getting angry and being ungrateful. No. It's just because he does not have the strength to fight against his evil inclination and against his natural desires. Why he does not have the strength? Because he does not take his daily antibiotic. What is the spiritual antibiotic? The Torah. That's the secret of life. The Torah kills the Yetzer Hara. This in the Gemara, Chazal say, Barati Yetzer Hara, I created the evil inclination, and I created the medicine for it. What is it? Torah, Tavlin. The Gemara used a very interesting word. They said that the Torah is compared to a spice. I give you an example. Let's say you make for Shabbos chulent for 500 people. You have in a shul, kiddush, I don't know, bar mitzvah. You have to make chulent, you know, in this big sirim, you know, the pots, huge ones for 500 people. So you put few of them. And now, by mistake, instead of putting red paprika to give it a good color and a good flavor, by mistake you put cinnamon. Cinnamon. Sweet cinnamon. Now the people come, wow, the children look so good. They eat it. They want to vomit. It's not, it's a cake, it's not children. What is it, cake with meat? It tastes like a cake. $5,000 worth of meat and food and everything went to the garbage for $2 spice. Paprika would be $2. You buy in Costco this red paprika. He put, finished. Why are you laughing? They make the chulent here with cinnamon?
My son.
Your son? You see, I smelled it. If two people here laughing and they related, there has to be something here. I pressed on someone's toe. You make chulent with cinnamon?
Sometimes.
Oh my God. I guess Hashem wanted you to hear that you better change your habits. Are you sure he's Syrian?
His mother is Ashkenaz.
Still, my wife is also Ashkenaz. She never thought of making it with cinnamon. Oh yeah. Anyway. Everyone eats what he likes. But I just use the example, just focus on the example. So the idea is the spice is only $2 or $1. The food can be $500 or $1,000. But the spice, the $1, is going to decide if people liked it or they vomit. The $1 makes more impact than the entire food. And that's what the Chazal wanted you to know, that even a little bit Torah, me'at min ha'or, mevriach harbe min ha'choshech, a little bit from the light already kick away so much of the darkness. Because if you have a big room, and it's totally dark, and you light one match compared to the room is huge, one in the middle of the room, one match. What happened after that? Already you can see people, images in the room. You don't see clear, but you see a lot already. You know where to go, the chairs, not to bang into them. This little match compared to the room is nothing. It's not even 1% of the capacity of the room, not even a tenth of a percent. But it already makes a big impact, because once you begin to learn Torah, you see an immediate impact. I remember I was once invited to speak in a learning program. Usually I don't go to learning programs. I give lectures. Learning programs, you have a lot of local rabbis. They can teach Gemara, Mishnah, Chumash, every shul. It's no problem. They don't need me for that, that's for sure. But the person that invited me did not let go. No, you have to come. Why I have to come? He said to me, because I'm bringing my friends, 20 years old, 20, 21 years old. And it's a once-in-a-lifetime opportunity. If he speaks to you, there's a chance. If not, who knows if he ever come again. He finally agreed to come. I need you to speak. Come even for half an hour. Now remember, I live over 2 hours away from the place. I live in Muncie. This was in Great Neck. In rush hour to get there, it's 2 hours ride. I said, okay, if that's what I have to do, I have to do. I got there. So the whole learning program for me was me and this guy, one-on-one. The rest, everyone, there were many tables, group of kids around the tables, learning with many different rabbis. Me and him alone. So I came, and I said, what will I talk to him about? Let me take a chumash. Let me read to him a few verses from the Torah. Some Musa. I told him, I showed him what Hashem thinks about certain things, some of the sins that we do. 40 minutes I talked to him. That's it, 40 minutes. After 40 minutes, he started to cry like a baby. His tears were falling on the chumash, flooded the pages. And he started to cry. How come no one ever told me these things? Grew up in public school, very handsome boy, long hair, rich family, sport car, unlimited amount of money, all the girls over there. How are you? How are you? Can we go out? Can we hang out? I don't have to tell you the test that he's running through. 40 minutes conversation, showed him about Shabbos and a few other things. Few key verses from Sefer Dvarim. His neshama, 40 minutes, first time in his life he hear Torah. First time in his life he hear Torah. 40 minutes. 20 years of sins and who knows what. Public school, kfira, heresy, whatever you can think of. 40 minutes. He started to cry like a baby. How, I'm so grateful to Hashem. I didn't know these things. I said to him, now you know, Baruch Hashem. Better late than never. What are you going to do about it? Of course I'm going to keep. He became fully religious. Got married to a religious Baalat Tshuva in a separate wedding. Became a Zakei Arabim. Was posting lecture online for people to mekarev them. 40 minutes conversation. This was maybe 12 years ago, 10 years ago, something like that. Maybe 12 years ago. Until today, it's fully form, fully religious. Now he's a kid. He made his parents religious. One time he came to me for Shabbos. And he said to me, my grandfather lives in Muncie. I say, your grandfather live in Muncie? Muncie is an ultra-Orthodox place. How your grandfather live in Muncie? I say, my grandfather, my mother's father, is a Vishnitz Hasid. Vishnitz Hasid? I thought you're Syrian, I say to him. Say, my father is Syrian. But my mother, she's Ashkenazi, Hasidah. But when she was young, she rebelled. She went off the derech. Now, do you think I should pay a visit to my grandfather? He never saw me for my bris. Over 20 years. He knows he has a grandson somewhere that grew up like a goy in public school and doesn't know anything from his life. That's all he knows. The Hasidish man, the grandfather. I said to him, of course, go, knock on his door. I said to him, do you know where he lives? He said, he lives by the Vishnitz Rebbe. So, okay, I tell you the street. Go over there, tell the name, the Hasidim, they know everything. Just say the name, they'll tell you right away where he lives. He went there. That's it, it was Motzei Shabbos. I think Monday or Tuesday, someone knocked on my door. Monsi, it's a place of chesed. People collect charity all the time. They knock on your door. No one is embarrassed. Hi, how are you? Tzedakah. I see a Hasidish man, 7 years old, standing by my door. I don't speak Yiddish. His accent, even if he tried to speak English, was very difficult to understand. I thought he wants tzedakah. But then when I opened the door, he grabbed my hand, started to kiss me, hug me. I said, what? What's going on here? Didn't know. I did not see the connection. From his broken English, finally I got the point. Thank you for bringing me my grandson back. I'm so excited. First time he sees his grandson, already Shomer Shabbat, with kippah, tzitzit. Came with the Shabbos suit, so b'chlali looks charedi. He did not go back to his jeans yet. So mamash, it was a very good impression. But this is it, Rabotai. 40 minutes of Torah sometimes ignite the soul. Of course, after that, I told him, you must stay connected, listen to CDs. People that listen to the CDs, without even realizing, it changed their entire life. It's 30 hours every CD. So when you're in a car, most people spend hours in a car every day. So you drive, you listen to 20 minutes, and half an hour, and 40 minutes, in different subjects. Parashat HaShavua, Musar, Jewish Hashkafa, proofs that the Torah is Min HaShamayim, proofs that the Gemara, the Oral Torah is also Min HaShamayim, all kinds of things that a Jew must hear. Must hear. And then after that, Rabotai, after that, the person starting to love it more and more, אחרי הפעולות נמשכים הלבבות. The Torah say, Hazal say it, it's written in Sefer HaChinuch also, אחרי הפעולות נמשכים הלבבות. This is a very key fundamental foundation in Judaism that most Jews are not aware of. Many people think, you want to make me religious rabbi? No problem. I'm cooperative. But tell me what you want me to do. And I'll tell you which things I like to do and which things I'm not ready for. I want you to be Shomer Shabbos. Close your business and come to Shul. Wow, come on, you're crazy. All my business is on Shabbos. How can I close the business? They're going to kick me out of the mall. My wife is going to divorce me. Come on, it's too much. Okay, let's go a little bit easier. Put tefillin 5 minutes a day, say Shema. Okay, this is, I can live with that. Started eating kosher. Okay, in the house I'll eat kosher, but when I'm away, where will I find kosher? It becomes a bargain, business. This I'm willing to do, this I'm not. So when you ask him, why this one you don't want to do? Because it's too hard for me. That's basically the answer. Right now it's too difficult for me, I'm not ready. The Torah says it doesn't work that way. You think, if I like it, if I'm attracted to it, I will do it. If I do not like this mitzvah, does not talk to me, I'm unable to do it. I'll give you an example. Some people are naturally generous. They're totally secular, even goyim. And they're very generous. Everyone who needs help, who comes to them, I need help, I need sponsorship, I need donation, how much you need? Whatever, he gives you the check, I don't, no argument. Very generous people. Some of them don't even believe in God. They just feel great about doing something good to somebody else, even if he's a stranger. Because that's their nature, it's like a drug addict. He needs right now his drug, otherwise he'll kill someone. So he will kill for the drug, no matter what, he'll break a car and get money there and go buy it, unfortunately. That's the reality. We all, in a way, are drug addicts, but we have different drugs than cocaine and heroin. The drugs that we have is our nature. Let me explain. Some people are very generous. If they see someone suffer and they won't be able right now to give, they'll suffer all day. If he comes to you and he says, can you give me money? I'm hungry. My children are hungry at home. We have leak in the house. We're freezing. If you had $1,000 in your pocket, immediately you would give him the whole thing. And you check in your pocket, wow, I didn't bring my wallet, I don't have money, I live far away from here. How will I help this guy? Okay, excuses, he leaves. He thinks you're telling him stories, but you really eat your heart all day. How couldn't I help this guy? Why did I forget my money? So what do you see? The only reason he would give him the money is not really for him. Is for himself, because he needs that drug to relax him. Do you understand what I'm saying here or no? If he won't give, he will suffer. That's his nature. Which one the Torah appreciates more? Someone that is very generous and he cannot live without helping others? Or someone that is very selfish and stingy and he forces himself to give because Hashem said so? Which one the Torah appreciates more? Clearly, Chazal speaking about it. Lefum tza'ara agra. The harder the mission is, the more reward it is. Now remember, the same mission by two different individual Jews. Moshe and Yitzchak. Moshe, it's a piece of cake for him. Whatever you ask him to do, to wake up in the morning. He wakes up every day when he was secular to run, to jog in the park, 6 a.m. already. He has no problem of waking up in the morning. This guy, Yitzchak, to get him out of the bed by 11 a.m., it was an impossible mission. Now he wakes up at 6:30 in the morning, at 7 he's already in a shul, but with such struggle, he comes, 3 cups of coffee to open up his eyes, this until he moves, until he puts the tefillin. You see that he's half asleep. The other one is full of energy. Which one gets a bigger reward for coming every morning to pray early? The one that suffers from it. Lefu tzara agra. Now you see that the nature of the people is totally different. What's easy for one is very difficult for the other. Same thing by women. Some women, they hear about modesty. Okay, I have to dress modest. If that's what Hashem say, no problem. I'm going to start working on it. 2 or 3 days later, she already bought herself all kinds of modest clothes. She went with a religious friend. A week later, she looks like a Drebitzen. And there is another girl, 10 years. 10 years of a war, and she's still not modest. Every day is a fight before she leaves the house. What should I wear? No, it's too much. It's too modest. Nah, it's old-fashioned. Here, non-stop fight. One girl, naturally modest. I'm not here to impress anyone on the street. The other one is very big yetzer hara for it. So you see, Rabotai, that every person, the Gemara say, כשם שפרצופיהם שונים, the same way that the face of every person is different than the other, the same way their nature and opinions is different than each other. You will not find two people in the world with the exact same opinions in every topic. It's no such thing. The greatest rabbis in history disagree on topics from the Torah. Topics, not that is a something that two people argue about in business or something. No, something about the Torah. One say that you should do it this way, and one say, no, you should do it this way. Why? The Torah is open sometimes to interpretation. So everyone brings his own common sense, and psak halacha shone michavero. One person say you should do it, one person say don't do it, it's a sin. We see many examples in the Talmud, Bet Shammai, Bet Hillel, big arguments in very important topics. One say left, one say right, 100%. So the same way the faces are different, the person is different. Hashem made everyone different fingerprints, different DNA. The chance of having the same DNA, someone explained to me, is 1 to 10 billion. Basically, it does not exist. Because we have only 7.5 billion people in the world. 1 to 10 billion, that means there's no two people with the same DNA. I really don't know where they came up with this statistic, 1 to 10 billion. In my opinion, it's 1 to 100 trillion. But besides the point, one way or the other, everyone agreed there's no two DNA that looks exactly the same. And you know, where my parents live in Israel, in Rehovot, in the synagogue, when I go there, there is a scientist from Mahon Weizmann, a big scientist, religious man, Argentinian. He lives in Israel probably 30 years by now. Still have Argentinian accent. And he's a scientist, Dr. Rabinovitz. And he is a mathematician among the things that he does. He had a video. It's very interesting. When I watched the video, I did not realize from the video that it's the person that sits next to me in the shul. I watched that video a few times. I sent it to people. But in my mind, I did not realize this is the nice Argentinian man that all the time when I come to shul, he comes to me, "Hi, Rabbi, how are you? Were you here?" Because I go to visit in Israel. All of a sudden, I said, "Wow, that's the guy sitting right next to me in a shul." He made a video about the DNA. Once you watch it, you get the shock of your life. He explains that the way the DNA is designed, you know, it looks like a spiral. And it's very, very long. And from here to here, there's like clips. Clips that hold it together, like a ring. And these rings is designed in a pattern. It's not random. You see, if I wanna put 100 sticks together and I want to tie it with ropes. So I put one rope here, one here, one here. It doesn't have to be an equal measurement. As long as you tie it good. No pattern. But the way Hashem tied the DNA with those rings, it's very hard for me to explain it. You have to be a scientist to know the right terms. But just get the point. that the way it's designed is that it has 10 rings attached, like 10 fingers, like this, space, then 5 rings, 5, space, 6 rings, space, 5 rings. That's the order. 10, 5, 6, 5. 10, 5, 6, 5. 10, 5, 6, 5. Yud-Kei Vav-Kei, the name of Hashem. In the DNA. Stamp of Hashem in the DNA. Unbelievable. Something like this can be random? Hard to believe. I'll give you another example. When Hashem does things in a creation, and many times if you're clever and have a sharp eye, you can see stamp on it. For instance, if you follow the news, you will know that Hashem basically drowned Iran now. Drowned them. With the biggest flood in their history. They're finished. You have to see. Hundreds of miles are all covered with water. To the point that tigers and leopards ran from the zoo and started to jump at people on the streets. With videos from Iran. Cannot believe it. Tigers, leopards running in the neighborhoods. Massive amount of water like the Niagara Falls. Taking cars with them. Taking businesses with them. Taking homes with them. Similar to what Hashem did to Paro and the other wicked people. But where is the stamp of Hashem? You can always claim nature. There's floods everywhere. Nature, nature, nature. How many boroughs you have in Iran? In New York you have 5 boroughs. How many boroughs you have in Iran? In the whole country, 31. How many of them drowned completely? 26. Hashem could have done all 31, but then it would look like nature. If he would do only 2 or 3, he'd say, it's not such a big deal. 26, it's almost everything, but it's exactly to show you, I am speaking to you from every detail in nature. By the way, it's written in a Gemara that everything Hashem does to the nations, to all the nations, is for the sake of the Jewish nation. In this particular case, we know Iran, the leaders of Iran, are planning to destroy Israel, God forbid. They're not hiding it. If they could, they would already do it. That's obvious that Hashem is helping us to survive these new Nazis of today's world. But what happens, sometimes you hear, I don't know, Puerto Rico, Dominican, places like this. That has nothing to do with Israel. Venezuela, Greece, places that we're not necessarily in a war with. They also get massive tragedies. Earthquake, Japan, Nepal, all these places. What is the purpose of this? Based on the Gemara, it was done for us. The answer is, a smart Jew learns from everything he sees around him. Because in Judaism, it's a crime to use the word coincidence. It's literally a crime. If a person says tzeruf mikrim, it's mikre, he break one of the key warnings in the Torah. Who knows which one? Where does it say in the Torah that you're not allowed to use the word mikre? Coincidence. In what parasha? Bechukosai. As the rabbi say, parashat Bechukosai. It's repeated there at least probably 7 or 8 times there. If im telchu imi bekeri, keri means mikre, af ani elech imachem bekeri. Then later Hashem increased the pressure. Im telchu imi bekeri, ani elech imachem bechamat keri. Meaning even more than what you do to me. Meaning measure for measure, but with more reaction. So what do you see? There's one thing Hashem does not like. I do something to wake you up in a world or in your neighborhood or to your life or to your parnasa or to your family or to whatever you see, and you come and say, bad luck, bad day. This guy did such and such bad things to me. Who is this guy? This guy is Hashem. And the other guy is Hashem, and the goy is Hashem, and this one is Hashem, and your own children is Hashem. Whatever happens to you, if it did not get the approval of Hashem, you wouldn't get it. Now it's very easy to run after this guy and to retaliate against this girl. But that's not how a Jew has to think. I got it, I deserve it. Why I got it? Let me start investigate my actions. That's what the Gemara say. The Gemara say, if a person see problems coming to his life, what does he have to do? Go to the beach and get a tan. Some people, that's what they will tell you. Go, relax, why are you so uptight? Come on, go! Go relax on the beach for a week, take a day off, take a week off, get some nice color, then come back to work, things will work out. That's not what the Torah says. The Torah says, if you see things don't work, immediately open up your eyes and begin to see what you're doing wrong. Yefashfesh b'ma'asav. Fishfesh ve'lo matza. You look, you cannot find. Everywhere, what am I doing wrong? I give tzedakah, I'm honest, I don't lie, I don't steal, I keep Shabbos, I daven, my wife is modest, she covered the hair, the children are in good yeshivot, I love Hashem, I believe in Hashem, I know everything is from Hashem, I never give myself credit, I'm not the type, kochi ve'otzem yadi asa li t'chayil hazeh. So what am I doing wrong? Check and check and check, cannot find. What's the end, the conclusion? Itle bebitul Torah. You're not learning enough Torah. What do you mean? I learn 6 hours every day. And I work 5 hours in a business. I learn more Torah. I fulfill what the Gemara say. The Gemara say, Ase Torah keva umelachtecha arai. Make the Torah, the learning of the Torah, the main thing in your life. And everything else secondary. If a person come in the morning to Shachritz, he finish around 8, and he sits until 1 or 2 p.m. and learn, and then he goes to the business until 6. Few hours he walks, he makes his shtadlut to bring bread home. What can be better than that? You still have to raise children, to pay bills. So half a day learn, half a day works. Fantastic. He tried everything. I'm perfect in everything. So why Hashem is doing it to me? Conclusion, you're not learning enough Torah. Do you know the Rambam is the main posek in the last 1,000 years, the biggest. 90% of Shulchan Aruch is Rambam, basically. By the Yemenite, their whole Shulchan Aruch is the Rambam. The Yemenites. When the Shulchan Aruch was written, it was for Sfaradim, later for Ashkenazim. Okay, thank you. The Temanim always live in Yemen. They follow the Rambam and their own rabbis. The Rambam writes, in the obligation of a person to learn Torah. How far it goes? How far it goes? You may think a person that is paralyzed in bed, lo aleinu, cannot move, chas v'shalom, had an accident. He cannot move his hands, cannot move his legs, nothing. Lay in bed. 1 year, 5 years. I know several people like this. I went to visit them. One visit like this is better than to read 10 Sifrei Musar. I learned hundreds of Sifrei Musar, and some of them 10, 20, 30 times. To keep myself on track, I must learn Musar. Otherwise, a week or two, I go down. Must finally wake up myself and judge myself and check myself and again, otherwise, 1 week without it, I go down. Some people have more tolerance, some people less. Some people, after one day, they go down. We see in a yeshiva when there's ben azmanim. A guy was learning 4 months from morning to night in Monsi. So serious. 3 weeks vacation come, he goes back to Brooklyn, walks in King's Highway 2-3 days, went back to the way it used to be almost. What about 4 months of devotion like this? Fire! How you went back to be almost secular? Rabbi, the test is unbearable. Let's see you walking 2 days here in the streets of Brooklyn in the summer. You tell me if you can stay religious. It's very difficult. The world becomes, in some places, like Sodom and Gomorrah of those days. Tzadik echad besdom, like we say. Tzadik among thousands of people that don't recognize Hashem b'chlal. Abomination everywhere, all kinds of things like this. And now you have to survive. It's not easy. It's really not easy. So The point, Rabotai, as I told you before, that if a person begins to step away from the Torah, you see the reaction of it right away. I sometimes go to visit these handicapped people, young people. I was in Israel a few months ago, hours before I got on my flight. My friend, since you're having your flight soon, pass by my house, we eat a light dinner, and then you go. Okay. I went to his house. Then a woman came, next door neighbor, in her 50s. Rabbi, my son asked if you can come visit him. He's next door. Right away, I understood that the son has limitation. Otherwise, he would come with her to see me. He wouldn't ask me to come next door. Right away, my heart started to go faster and faster. When I said, Hashem Yirachem, what do I have to see now? And then my friend said to me, her son had a motorcycle accident, 20-something years old, on a wheelchair for the rest of his life. Cannot even go to the bathroom. I went to visit him. I see the way he cries. And he said to me, I sit here all day, listen to you from morning to night. I have nothing else to do in life. That's all I'm doing, sitting here. I cannot even go to the bathroom. Sometimes my mother goes, nobody's here. I sit here, I'm dying here, sitting in a chair. Cannot go to the bathroom. I have to wait until someone will come and take me to the bathroom. Every time I go to the bathroom, it's a nightmare. It's a Kriyat Yam Suf. I have to sit like this for 50 years, Rabbi, and you're telling me to believe in Hashem, to have emunah, to have confidence that it's for my own good? Easy to talk. What am I supposed to answer him now? It's not once, not twice. It happens many times. Motorcycle is a murder machine. You don't understand how many people in Israel became paralyzed from motorcycles. People get it because they want to save traffic. Yeah, okay, you save time every day, half an hour. But mamash, you play with fire. I doubt it if it's bechlal allowed from the Torah to ride on a motorcycle. When you see so many accidents, hundreds of percent more than cars. Not a little bit more. Hundreds of percent. It's enough there's a bump on the street or a paddle and you can fly 100 yards in the air. It's mamash a dangerous thing. Or if it's raining, you can slide. Horrible things that happens with this. Maybe it's against the Torah to use it. Maybe. Some people, they have a hobby. They like to jump from planes. Parachuters. For fun. One of them asked my rabbi, he said, I went, I think, I don't remember if it was 1,000 times or 10,000 times. Many times he jumped from a plane. And he said to him, it's against the Torah to choose such hobbies. There's accidents. Why? It's not that you need to, you're not a soldier. Soldiers, he has to protect the land. So he's allowed. But you, well, you're not a, why are you picking up such things that Chas v'Shalom can kill you or can, who knows what can happen? The Torah says, "V'nishmartem lenafshotechem," you have to watch your health, you have to watch your safety. You cannot play with fire. Your life, you don't owe them. You do not own your life. If a person commits suicide, he's being judged like he murdered himself, as a murderer. It's not allowed. Right? This pasuk in the Torah, the HaKadosh Baruch Hu will demand the blood of yourself from your hand. Why? Because who gave you permission to commit suicide? I give life and I take life. I decide when the soul goes in and I decide when the soul goes out. You interfere with my plan in a creation? You interfere with that? So going back to what I started to explain. So a person begins to check and he does not find anything. The Gemara say, you're not learning enough Torah. But I learn half a day. Let's go to what the Rambam say. The Rambam say, a person that is poor and he has no food for his children, mechazer al haptachim, he goes from one apartment to another, knock on the door, collect a dollar, collect $2, collect 50 cents, collect $2. All day like this. He has kids, he has to send them to yeshiva, he has to pay rent, he has to pay electric, he has to pay whatever, he has to pay transportation, clothing. minimum, he needs $10,000 not to starve. Where is he going to get it? He's unemployed all day, collecting dollar by dollar. That's his job. 13, 14 hours a day. There are people like this. That's how they feed their children. All day, going to collect money. Lo aleinu, such a punishment. All your life to have this shame, to go beg people for money. A person like this, you may think, is dismissed from learning Torah. The Rambam writes, "Ani amechazer al haptachim eno patur mitalmud Torah." I must learn Torah. Mukeshchin, someone that has like leprosy, pus all over his skin, all kinds of bubbles, problem, itching. He cannot live. Full rash all over his body. I'm dying. I'm itching. I'm going crazy. You have to sit and learn, Habibi. You're not dismissed. Mukeshchin, a person. Half an hour before he dies, he wants to see his children, to say goodbye to them, to give them the last blessing. Lo patur mitalmud Torah. I tell you something. One time there was one bachur in yeshiva that wasn't feeling well. Somebody took yozma, someone agreed to go to each one of the bachurim to donate something spiritually for the health of this bachur. So he came to one guy, what are you going to do for our friend? I'm going to learn the whole Masechet for him. Masechet Kiddushin. For his refuah. Beautiful. What are you going to do? I read 10 times the whole Tehillim for him. Very nice. What are you going to do? I finish Shisha Sidre Mishnah for him. Wow. Beautiful. Psh, write it down. He goes from one person to another. I'm going to do Tomche Shabbos for him for the whole year. I go twice a week. I give boxes to poor people. That's for his refuah. Everyone in the yeshivat donated a lot. Then he came to the mashgiach, the supervisor. He say, I'm going to donate 1 minute of my Torah learning every day to him. 1 minute. So this bachur had a little bit chutzpah. Said to him, Kvod Arav, are you joking? This guy did the whole Masechet. This guy, 10 Sifrei Tehillim. This guy, the whole Mishnah, yes. You're giving me 1 minute? For this. You don't care about this Bachur? He gave him such a look. It happened in reality. He looked at him, he said, do you know how much I do in 1 minute Torah? Do you know how much I do in 1 minute? What do you think, a minute is nothing? A minute? A minute can be a whole life. I give you an example. Who can tell me what is the value of 1 minute of life if you have to evaluate it with money? Technically, the answer is nothing. I'll tell you why. If you're 90 years old and the doctor say to you, we can extend your life by 1 minute if you pay $1,000. What would you say? For 1 minute, what is it going to give me anyway? I'd rather give the $1,000 to my children. Let them buy some falafel, something, be happy. Right? So a person does not really evaluate the 1 minute if he's not Ben Torah. But if someone understands that a minute, it can be eternity, a minute of tshuva, a minute of regret, a minute of shame, a minute of mamash tshuva me'omek alev can change your eternity. And I'll give you a proof for it. According to the Torah, if one person murdered another one, what's the punishment for it? Death penalty. The Torah does not take the murderers and give them a beautiful jail with plasma TV, peanut butter and jelly, college degree, olive oil with za'atar, playing soccer and basketball, and paying them 2,000 shekel a month for being in jail. Free cell phone, sitting in a computer, enjoying, playing sheshbesh. Wow, it's very great to be a Palestinian terrorist. Fantastic. Life is better than Gaza. I didn't have food like this over there. Yogurt. You saw the terrorist that murdered a few kids in a hospital, how the Israeli nurses giving him yogurt and giving him fruits. we have to take care of our murderers. Why? Because there's no Torah. You have Torah, you would know how to deal with them. But if a person murdered someone else, if there was Sanhedrin and the witnesses testify and everything is legit, death penalty. Now let me ask you a question. If he murder a person that is 20 years old, or if he murder a person that is 120 years old, there is any difference in the punishment? This guy had another 67 years to live, the 20 years old. The other one has a minute to live, another day maximum. He's 120 years old already. He's not going to live that long. Anyway, cannot function. He, Chas v'Shalom, has Alzheimer. Who knows what he has? His life is not exactly like the 20 years old guy that is steiging in yeshiva now. But there's no difference. Where is the justice? It's not fair. I'm sorry. It's not fair. If someone steals from you $10, he came to your pocket, stole from you $10, and went bought himself two slices of pizza because he was hungry. Or someone stole from you $10,000, the court will give them the same punishment? No. For $10, the judge will get angry at the police. Are you really that dumb? You're wasting the time of the court for $10, hungry person that stole $10 to buy pizza? You really that dumb that you think that's what we have now to deal with $10 issues? $10,000, oh, that's already a criminal. We have to judge him. Because we understand that not every case is the same. Even though we say in Judaism, din pruta ke din mea, meaning if you steal one coin, you're still a thief. But it's not the same punishment. Because according to the Torah, if you steal 1,000, you have to give 2,000. If you steal 1,000,000, you have to pay by 2,000,000. A double penalty. So the more you steal, the more you have to pay back. So you see that the punishment is accordingly. The answer is, Rabotai, I heard it once from my rabbi, it's shocking. He said, you see that even if you took 30 seconds from the life of a person, you disconnected him from the machine 30 seconds before he was dying anyway naturally. Naturally. The machine already beeping. Beep, beep, the doctor say, any minute. And you say, you know what, I can't take these beeps. You disconnected it. Ah, you took a minute from his life. Two witnesses saw you. If there was Sanhedrin, you're guilty like a regular murderer. You won't be able to say, come on, I had mercy on the old man. I'm not a murderer. I'm a good person. Good Samaritan. I had mercy on him, so I took 1 minute of misery from his life. It's 100% murder. Not only that, Rav Eliashiv Zatzal is posek that even if you took few minutes away from the life of this Jew to use his organs to save the life of 4 Jews that would die without it. You have 4 young Jews. This guy needs a kidney because both kidneys stop to work. This guy need lung, this guy need liver. You can take it from this person who anyway is dying in a few minutes, take the organs and save the life of 4. And this guy will die an hour earlier. This looks like a very good deal, no? Save 4 with the life, with the organs of someone that anyway is considered dead. Rav Eliashiv says 100% murder. And dochim nefesh mipnei nefesh. We don't have permission to shorten the life of a Jew by 1 second even. So you see that even taking 1 minute of life from a person, there's no difference between you and someone who murdered I don't know how many people. Same punishment. Now you begin to understand the value of 1 minute of life. You see that even for 1 minute, it's the same like taking 100 years of someone's life. For the 1 minute alone, it's already a tragedy. 1 minute. How do you prove a person the value of Shabbat? You can tell him we eat chulent. Big deal. I eat steaks in a restaurant. We think, I go to the bar, I listen to blues. Okay, we dress nice. I'm a lawyer, I dress nice every day. We enjoy with our wife and children. I do it every day. I don't need one day a week to do it. How are you going to convince a secular person about the value of Shabbat? What are you going to tell him? We go to shul and we pray. Ooh, God forbid. That's the last thing I want to do. I don't want to waste my time reading from a book. Everything you tell him, he's a wise guy. He has an answer. We're learning Torah. I'm allergic to Torah. How am I going to convince this guy about the value of Shabbat? Everything you tell him, he has an answer. No, give me an idea. What would you tell him? How you convince a person that lives in the darkness about what is the value of Shabbat? Do you have an idea? Telling him, come over for Shabbat and see how wonderful we live. If he agreed, then he will really see. It will affect him, for sure. But to bring him, it's not easy. He thinks, I'm okay. Live and let live. Leave me alone. I'm happy. You're happy. Stay the way you are. I stay the way I am. How you can convince him that he lives in a total lie? He's in a total direction. His journey is in the opposite side of Hashem. Hashem is there and he's there. Going to the opposite side and he's not even feeling it. He thinks, I'm great. I feel great. One rabbi once gave a beautiful mashal. It was in a seminar that I participated 22 years ago. It was a very famous rabbi in Israel, one of the biggest. So he said in his last speech, that was the final speech of the seminar. And he said to the audience over there, he said, really, when a person goes into a bathroom, public bathroom, what is the first reaction? Oof, terrible smell. I can't breathe. When I go to those bathrooms, I take a long breath before. I put my sleeve on my nose like this, and I run quickly, and I hope that I'll be able to get out of there alive. Technically, it's the worst place to be. But when you walk in, you see the amigo over there cleaning the windshield, the window. Everyone is dying there. And he's there all day. ¿Cómo está, señor? Oh, ¿qué pasa? Well, you don't have a nose? Now take him out. Hey, amigo, come. Cerveza on me. You buy him nice beer, drink a Mexican beer. Now he comes back into the bathroom. What's the first reaction? Oof, I didn't know it's so bad here. What this mashal, what do you learn from it to life, about life? No?
Once you experience something better, it's hard to downgrade to go back.
That's true, but it can be a little bit deeper. Yeah? Yes, you get used to the horrible environment and horrible smell. You already live among these people, you live around the scene, you live about a bed avira. The Gemara says, avira de Eretz Israel machkima. Just breathing the air in Eretz Israel, open up your brain. Make you sharp. You see, it's very interesting. From all the Arabs in the world, you have 1.7, 1.8 billion Arabs. Who are the sharpest, the sneakiest, and the most conniving ones?
Israeli Arabs.
Who?
Israeli Arabs.
Palestinians. Go on CNN. How they fool the whole world. And everyone buy their lies. They don't even blink. They tell story, genocide, propaganda. This, we were here. You never had a nation. You never had a flag. You never had a government. You don't have one history book. Now one museum. You don't have a record because you never existed until 1964. They still convince the whole world what's going on here. They so clever in their lies how they fool the whole world. In the end, Hashem is going to make justice to everyone. Don't worry too much, but where do they get this sneaky, clever mind? From where? They live in Eretz Israel. Avira de Eretz Israel machkima, even if you're going. and makes you more clever. Look at the Israeli kids compared to the American kids. I go to Eretz Israel, I see 11 years old kid, they tell you the whole Chumash by heart, word by word, 11 years old. What grade is this, fifth grade? Every parasha, they tell you the whole parasha by heart. Look at the Chumash, you cannot believe it. American kid, in the best yeshivot, where anywhere you want. You know 11 years old that can tell you the whole Chumash by heart? You have kids in Eretz Israel from such young age that tell you all the Mishnayot, everything, all the opinions. You say, wow. It's a whole different world. Why? Avira de Eretz Israel machkima. They're also more aggressive. It's different mentality. Many American kids are pleasant, soft. They come to Israel, they get the shock of their life. They're not used to it. I see from my Baalei Tshuva that made Aliyah. Some of them have a nightmare placing their children in schools. They don't know what to do. Some of them even came back because of that. Why is it? It's a whole different league, different mentality, different level of learning. Everything is different. Avira de Eretz Israel machkima. So if you live now inside the bathroom all day, he said that one time he walked in Yerushalayim in a construction site. And the sewer did not work there that day. I don't have to tell you what happened in the neighborhood that the sewer does not work. Nobody can breathe over there. And he saw six Arabs sitting in a circle, eating their hummus and pita, sitting, talking. None of them feel anything. Why? Because they walk there every day from morning to night. They get used to the smell. The Torah shows you, Habibi, you're going to be in a darkness. You get used to the darkness. When you walk into a dark room, in the first few seconds, you don't see anything. What happened after 20 seconds? You see everything. What happened to your eyes? They adjust to the darkness. אחרי הפעולות נמשכים הלבבות. After the actions, follows the hearts. Not the other way around. You begin to do something, you'll get used to it. For good and for bad. For good and for bad. There's not one thing in life that you cannot force yourself to get used to it and to like it. I saw in a book of Rabbi Hoffman, he was the biggest psychologist, Haredi, in the history of Israel. He was such a great psychologist that even rabbis like the Stipler and the biggest rabbis in Israel did not move an inch before consulting with him what to do with Talmidim that had depression, students that could not function. Whatever Hoffman say, that's what we do. He was so good that even the Israeli secular judges decided if to let a prisoner go out of jail on good behaving, only if he will recommend. That's how powerful he was. Not only that, he actually convinced the Israeli secular court to change the rules by proving that they are wrong. In one case, what was the case? There was one thief. They asked him, did you break into that house and stole all these things? He said, yes. Hoffman said, Your Honor, I can prove to you that he's not the thief. So what do you mean? He admitted. The laws over here is, if you admit, you're guilty. Even the Gemara says, Odat Baal Din Kemea Edim Dami. If you admit, you owe 100, it's like 100 witnesses testified that you owe. You don't need them. Your mouth make yourself guilty. You have to pay. But it's very interesting. Because according to the Torah, you're guilty only when it comes to money, nezakim, damages, death. But if you come and say, I'm the murderer, they're not allowed to believe you. I murder. You execute me. No. We need witnesses. What do you need witnesses? I'm telling you, I'm the murderer. Not allowed to kill him. Why? He just said that he's guilty. There are a few reasons why you cannot touch him until you have witnesses, kosher witnesses. Why? One option is, maybe he wants to die, to commit suicide. You know you're not allowed to die. Let someone else kill me. That's one option. He could be very depressed, bitter from life. He doesn't want to leave. Let me take the blame. Okay, that's one option. Second option, people that their conscience is functioning very highly and they have guilty feelings about their sins, sometimes when they get away with their sins or the crimes, they're very happy to take the blame on a crime they did not do to make their conscience relax. It's a psychological phenomenon. Meaning, I give you an example. There was one Moroccan Jew who came from Morocco with Aliyat Noir. You know what Aliyat Noir means? 16, 17 years old Moroccan kids without their parents. They made Aliyat to Israel 50, 60 years ago. They brought them into Israel and they put them in some kibbutz or moshav. Their parents stayed in Morocco, their old parents. One of them came to Israel when he was 16. I don't have to tell you that some kids, if their parents are not around, they're not exactly going to learn in school. There's nobody to tell them what to do. They begin to become criminals, all day walking around, doing bad things. This Moroccan guy started to be a criminal, robbing places, stealing for a living. He gets arrested. He goes out, 1 year after that, he goes out of jail. Then he gets arrested again, 2 years in prison. He comes out. After a few times in and out, now they need to decide, the committee, if to let him out on good behaving. They say, you know, we don't move an inch without Hoffman. Whatever Hoffman say, that's what's going to happen. You have to meet Rabbi Hoffman. So he came to meet Rabbi Hoffman. And Rabbi Hoffman said to him, listen, I recommended for you to go out first time. I recommended second time. I don't mind to recommend again, but you're ruining my reputation. Now I'm going to recommend to release you again, and another week you're going to rob another car or another house. I want to recommend, but in one condition, that you promise me you're not going back to crime. Because if you want to go back to crime, you better stay here. The guy told him, don't recommend, Rabbi, you're right. You should not recommend for me to go out. I don't deserve to go out. You know me, I'm going to go back into crime. So he said to him, why are you acting like a loser? Why can't you just work on yourself and change? No. Then he started to ask him about his parents. In Morocco, what are your parents doing? So my parents are righteous people. They're very religious. So are you in touch with them? He said, no. He said, since you came to Israel, you're not in touch with your parents? He said, my father sends me letters, but I never open them. He said to him, why, you don't like your father? He said, I love my father. I respect him very much. So why don't you open the letter? You don't want to know what's with your family? He said to him, Rabbi, I don't deserve to open my father's letters. Where is my father and where is me? I don't deserve to open the letters. So when Hoffman was keep convincing him, come on, do tshuva, stop stealing. At one point he broke and he said, okay, I give you my word. Shake my hand. Promise me. Your word for me, I take it. I have faith in you. I'm going to tell the judge to release you. Tomorrow you'll be out. But promise me you don't go back into crime. Once he shook his hand, he ran to the locker room and took all the letters and quickly opened them one by one. His conscience did not let him open the letters. He's punishing himself for what he deserved to get on his own. That's a system in the human being, if he's honest, if he has honesty in it. So Hoffman said to the judge, I can prove to you about a different case that this guy did not rob the place. He said to him, he admitted. He says, sometimes criminals admit and it's not them. If you take him to the site where the robbery took place and ask the police, to ask him, show us how you walked into the building, you will see that he has no idea from what window was broken and how the thief broke into the building. He will not know anything, even though he said, I'm the thief. They took him over there. The judge got killed. Remember, it's against the law in Israel. The law was until that day, if you admit, that's it. The case is closed. The judge was curious. He said to the police, please take him over there. We'll meet again tomorrow. The next day, the policeman say, he has no idea. The robbery was from the south. He took us from the north, different window. Nothing. He has no idea about anything over there. They changed the law in Israel that from then on, every criminal that admits must show how the crime took place. Murder, robbery, rape, anything. You must go and go over it. And if you see he does not know the details, the police cannot close the case. They have to continue to investigate. Now the question is, why would a person say I'm a murderer if he didn't murder? Option number one, he wants to die. He's tired of life. Option number two, he's so depressed, he's not aware of what he's doing. When you're in deep depression, some women drown their babies in a bath from afterbirth depression. Is that what she wanted to do? Of course not. But sometimes it destroys the mind. Other option, which is a very common one, the person that murdered is a big gangster. And he say to you, you're going to say you the killer. If not, I'll kill your whole family. You're going to say you the murderer. And don't worry, we're going to send your family $1 million and every month we'll send them money for the 20 years you'll be in prison. And we own the prison. We'll take care of you inside. You're going to have cell phone. You're going to have free visit. Nobody will mess with you. The police will take care of you. You're going to have special delivery. You're going to have contain card. And we'll take care of your children. Whatever you want. College, we'll pay for it. This, we'll pay for it. Car, we'll pay for it. Anything, it's on us. Say that you're the murderer. Very good deal for him. He makes 5,000 shekels. Cannot pay his tuition. Let me sit in jail, enjoy the air condition, play a little bit hockey there, billiard, and that's it. So how do you know he's the murderer? You don't know. That's why the Torah says, Habibi, person en adam mesim atzmo rasha. That's what it means, dinei nefashot. You have to have witnesses. Even a camera, by the way, it's not acceptable in a court, in a bed din. Today we don't judge dinei nefashot. There's no nafkamina. But if there was Sanhedrin today, and you show a security camera that a person came and shot and killed someone, you cannot convict him based on a video. You can't. Why? The Torah says, edim. Shnei edim, minimum two witnesses you need. So now let's go back to what I started. The obligation to learn Torah never ends. It's true that man has more obligation to learn Torah than a woman. Woman, for instance, she doesn't need to learn Talmud. She doesn't have to learn Gemara or Mishnayot. She doesn't have to learn Zohar. She has to know what she needs to know to function as a righteous woman. I say it easily. Easily, woman has to learn what she has to know. How many years she has to learn to know what she has to know? Who knows? How many years a woman has to learn many hours every day to be a kosher wife, to be a kosher woman, to be fully modest, to know the laws of kashrut, to know in the kitchen what to do, to know so laws of Lashon Hara, laws of the holidays, laws of Nida, Mikveh, husband, raising children, how to be a wife, how to keep Shabbos fully. How many years? 10 times more than what you have to learn to be a doctor. Some women, you tell them, you have great potential. You can be a great doctor. How many years I have to learn? 7 years. Not interested. Let me do speech therapy. How long? 3 years. Why? You're genius. All your tests is 100. You can be a great doctor. I'm not interested. I don't want to learn 7 years now to be a doctor and then 2 more years stage and all these 10 years of my life. I'm not interested. To be a righteous girl, she has to learn a lot more than to be a doctor. Do you know how many halachot apply to women? It's true. She doesn't need to know Rashi and Tosfot and Shnai Mochazin Betalit. No, that's not what Hashem wants from women. By the way, why Hashem does not want that women will learn Gemara? If a woman wants to learn Gemara, why to stop her? The Gemara says someone who teaches daughter Gemara, it's like teaching her Tifla, meaning Chas v'Shalom, bad things. Why? Once I had a girl in a seminary that Baruch Hashem, I was mekarev her and brought her to the Midrashiyah in Monsi for the girls. She was a very intelligent girl. A mas sharp, smart girl. They met smart girl. You saw, not a regular woman. She has a brain like a rabbi. And also Yirat Shamayim. So she said to me, I don't see any taste in living a life like the way the religious world expects from me. It's to get married, to raise children, to clean, to be a housewife. That's not the life I want. So what kind of life you want? I asked her. I want to learn all day Gemara. Rashi, Tosfot, Maharsha. So you out of your mind? That's what I love. It makes me very happy. I can sit for hours. They all go, they walk, they do babysitter. That's all I do. Try to understand the Gemara on my own. Some kind of a reincarnation of a big rabbi she is. She has to be. I had to convince her not to fall too deep into the Talmud because once you're in it, it's very hard to stop. It's very addictive. Very addictive. There are people that are so much in the Gemara. Rav Ovadia Yosef had a surgery. They needed to open his stomach open with a sword. Sword to cut the skin or the knife. He said to the doctor, don't give me anesthesia. He said, what? He said, I don't want to be sleeping for 3 hours. Why? What do you care? No. 3 hours of Bitul Torah. I want you to operate on me when I'm awake. So, yeah, Rabbi, you're out of your mind. You can faint from the pain. Give me some painkiller. No, it's not going to help. I have to cut your stomach open. He said to him, no, don't worry. Just wait for me. I'm going to start learning in a Gemara. Wait 5-10 minutes. Once you see I'm very into the Gemara, you can do whatever you want. And he operated on him while he was learning Gemara and he did not make a beep. How is it? Because the brain sends pain through the nerve system to the place based on knowledge. But if you're not aware that someone is cutting you up, you're not even aware. It's not in your mind. You are in something else. Now, to be honest with you, when I heard that story, first thing I thought, fairy tales. Come on, who can have a surgery without anesthesia? When did I start to believe that story? Well, you're giving me too much credit. Well, I did it myself. Me, you pinch me like this, I faint. So, when did I start to believe that story? When I saw in my own eyes such a bizarre scene. The unbelievable scene. What? Bibi Netanyahu, Benjamin Netanyahu, with all his bodyguards and walkie-talkie, all these Mossad gorilla, came into his room while he was learning. They stand next to him for 40 minutes. Such an embarrassment. They thought it's going to take a minute. The Shama said, Kvod Rav, but it's in the book. And Netanyahu said, don't disturb the Rav. He just said, every second. He was standing. I don't know if it was 40 minutes, but it was definitely long, long, long time. Standing there like a fool. You know how embarrassing it is? People filming. He stand like this. Until they had to shake him, Kvod Rav, and scream in his ear, Kvod Rav, Rosh HaMemshala po. He saw him, he got up, oh, Mechila, Shalom Alechem. Rosh HaMemshala stand one step from your head, and you hear the people talking, walkie-talkie, noise in the room. He's not in the room. There's another story about him, just to show you what Torah is. You hear these stories, you begin to get the point. When he was in his early 20s, Mamash, 20 years old, he broke his two legs and went into the hospital. And one very big Ashkenazi rabbi, old, came to visit him in the hospital. He didn't know him personally. 80 years old rabbi come to visit a 20 years old young Sfaradi boy in a hospital. It's not something that happens every day, no? Imagine the rabbi have to visit every 20 years old that goes to the hospital. They're not gonna have time to learn. People were very curious if there is any connection between them. They ask him, Rabbi, you know this Ovadia? No. So why you went to visit him? He said, I heard how he broke his legs and I figure I must pay him a personal visit. Everybody got curious. So how did he break his legs? He needed to get a book from the library in a yeshiva from the top shelf. He cannot reach, so you have a ladder. They have a ladder in yeshiva. He climbed on a ladder all the way to the top. He took out the book and he was standing on a ladder and learning. 10 minutes, 20 minutes. He was learning. Then he started to walk. He forgot he's on a ladder. And he fell from the ladder and broke his two legs. When I heard that there is a 20 years old boy that broke his legs like this, for me it's clear that one day will be Gdol Ador. I want to go now to pay him a visit. This is just to give you an idea. Rav Shach, he went with a watermelon to his wife, sent him to buy a watermelon. He came back home with the Gemara and no watermelon. She said, where is the watermelon? Oh, it fell on the street. I can give you hundreds of stories like this. The biggest rabbis in the world, once they're in the Gemara, they're not in this world. Mamash, different world. Anyway, Rabotai, I want to now focus on something that we all need very much. We all, with no exception to the rule. Who knows what is the official signature of Hashem? When Hashem signed His name, from all the options that He has, Hashem is everything, right? He's merciful, He's kind, He's this, He's that, He's generous. I can give you 1,000 things that Hashem is right from the top of my head. From all the options, take all the compliments that you can give God. Everything. Everything. Powerful, the smartest, the brightest, whatever, you name it. From all of them, Hashem needed to make Himself a ring. You know the ring how they used to stamp in the old days? Everyone makes Himself a ring. Whatever you want to design on a ring. Hashem made Himself a ring. What is the ring? Huh? Chotamo shel HaKadosh Baruch Hu Emet. Chotamo shel HaKadosh. The stamp of Hashem is the truth. The truth. What about wisdom? What about generosity? What about powerful? What about so many things? Merciful? You name it. It's not important. Everything is important. What's the most important? Emet. Chotamo shel HaKadosh Baruch Hu Emet. Now, what does it mean, Emet? Not to be a liar? Obviously. This even the Goyim knows. A Goy, Tony. He has a friend, Vini, that lies all day. He gets angry at him. He's such a liar. I don't want to be a friend anymore. How Tony knows to get angry at Vini? Every normal person knows that liars are not exactly the best people. Don't need Torah for it. Right? In Zimbabwe, two people over there in the middle of nowhere. If one lied to the other, will he get angry? He never heard of the Torah. He never heard of Hashem. He's in Zimbabwe. He never heard of it. He knows that it's not good to be a liar or a thief or anything else. But that's not what I'm talking about. That's needless to say. The Torah doesn't say don't lie. The Torah says midvar sheker tirchak. The Torah doesn't say don't be with your wife when she's impure before she went to the mikveh. The Torah uses a different language sometimes. Elisha benidat umata lo tikrav legalot ervata. Don't come near her in any situation, touch her, hug her, transfer a plate from hand to hand, that it would lead to contact, that would lead to intimacy. Already put the fence far away before you fall into the hole. Once you make such a scene, Shem Yirachem. One of the 36 worst sins of the Torah. One time I was called to give a speech at 7 p.m. until 7:45. On my way to my weekly lecture in Brooklyn. Can you come a little bit earlier? Why? Stop by the taxi company, car service. There's a few Israeli drivers. They sit in dispatch, in the office, waiting for a ride. Give them a 45-minute speech and then drive to your lecture. If I come all the way to Brooklyn, I grab two birds with one stone, no? Better. Okay, no problem. I gather at 7. I don't think there are 7, 8 drivers. That's it. Small group. I started to talk. I speak strong, you know. If I cannot speak strong and shake the people, waste of time for me. Better not to talk. The idea is to teach Torah, but at the same time to wake people to think I am not in the right path. I better wake up before it's too late for me. I can miss the train, God forbid. That's the idea here. That's what the Torah demands, by the way. To rebuke the people as pleasant as you can be. You have to know who you're dealing with, of course, but you have to shake them up, to wake them up. So I started to talk there. There was one driver over there that I saw right away is in. He came, talked to me after. I say to him, why don't you come to my lecture? I go now to give a lecture. It was Monday nights back then. I speak in Israeli house in Flatbush. It's owned by a billionaire that gives the house for Israeli guys to live there for free in one condition. They have to learn Torah from 8 to 10. They live there for free. 3 floors, rooms, food. Very nice. Every night someone speaks. My night was Monday night. I said to him, come to my lecture. I give a lecture here in Hebrew. Yeah, now? I say, now, nah, yalla, no. Anyway, I don't have anything to do now. He came with me to the lecture. He came a few weeks, next Monday. I saw this guy is serious. He heard? He's in. Top. Now I say to him, when I saw that his mama's serious, I want to invite you to my house for Shabbat. He said to me, wow. Where is it? I said, Monsi, it's about 1.5, 2 hours away from here. You come, you sleep by me, you eat by me, don't worry. So, wow, I would love to, but there's a little problem. What's the problem? I live with my girlfriend and her friend, 2 girls. We share an apartment. Can I bring my girlfriend with me? Now, what are you going to do now? You have religious kids in the house. You cannot bring a guy with his girlfriend, they're not married, they touch each other, they don't know the rules. So, Chilul Hashem, the kids may get the wrong impression here. Oh, my father is not upset. Everything is kosher. So I'm thinking, I don't want to lose him. I don't want to make scenes, but I don't want to lose him. If I tell him no, he's going to say, hey, what kind of a rabbi is this? I want to come, I want to bring another Jew in his... They don't understand. You understand? You have to talk to him in a language that he will be able to understand. So I said to him, okay, you can bring your girlfriend, but she's going to sleep by my neighbor. I cannot let you sleep in my house, you know, in front of the kids. They're going to start asking questions. Oh, yeah, I understand. No problem. Next door. He said, by the way, I don't want to be chutzpah. Maybe I can convince her friend also to come. Chaver mevi chaver. Okay. I say, she's going to agree? She say, yes. They both work as waitresses in a shish kebab restaurant. I work in a taxi company. So we can come, all 3 of us. We're all roommates. I say, fine. So they both going to be by my neighbor, and you sleep by me. There's also a few other guys. Okay. They came to me for Shabbat. We give divrei Torah Friday night, Shabbos morning. We speak. Now, I want to ask you a question. You have a guy that is, has a good neshama. He grew up like a goy. He doesn't know anything from his life. But now he woke up. And his girlfriend Now hearing from him also, and she listens to lecture, so she's in it. She agreed to come for Shabbat. And they're going to get married, and it's going to be a kosher home in Am Yisrael. And the other girl also came, and she's also interested. Three neshamot to save. Now what, when you speak to a boyfriend and a girlfriend that lives in the same apartment together, you already know what's going on over there. Isurei karet, the worst sins that you can imagine. Not married, and not supposed to be together. So, everyone left to their rooms. It's me and three of them. I sit here, and they sit on the other side of the table. And I give a speech about Nida, the laws of Nida. What does it mean, mikveh, all these things. I speak to them in a very respectable way. I see a guy is moving in a chair, you know, body language, like a torture. And I say to him, why don't you separate until the wedding? You're going to get married, you two righteous people. Separate for 3 months, make tshuva, and then get married in purity. Why to get married when you actually already married before the kiddushin? It's not the right way. No, you're right, I understand that perfectly, but there's one problem. We cannot afford to rent another apartment. We barely pay the rent here. It's New York, it's expensive. Ahmad, you want me to rent an apartment on my own and they're gonna rent an apartment? I cannot afford it. I say, you don't have to rent an apartment. I put you in the yeshiva and I put them in the midrashia. You don't have any rent. Any rent. He said, no, yeshiva, work. I said, until the wedding, that's it. No, we can't. I cannot come to yeshiva. No, they work in a restaurant, they can't quit. So I say to him, okay, at least be shomer negia. Don't touch each other until the wedding. I know it's not easy, but try. You make tshuva. Rabbi, you know, it's difficult, this, that. I saw that I'm losing the battle here. I had an idea. I say to him, you know what? Let's ask Hashem what he wants. He looks at me. This was one of the key moments. He looks at me, what do you mean, let's ask Hashem? I say to him, we're going to do Goral Agra. Goral. There's Goral Achida, Goral Agra, there's Goralot. You make a special prayer, you open the Chumash, the Torah, what comes on the right side, that's the message. But you have to do it. He looks at her, what do you think? She says, yes. Let's do it. I say to him, repeat after me. I made out a special prayer right away on the spot. Dear God, in Hebrew, please show me the way. Show me what you want me to do. What is my next step? Show me the way. I'm trying. Help me out here. For a minute or two, we say, mamash me'omek alev. Mamash, it was a moment of inspiration. I say, and he repeats after me. I get excited, he gets excited. I say to him, yalla, open. Boom! Open the chumash. First row on the right side, not second. First row. Ve'elisha benidat tumata lo tikrav legalot ervata. The girl ran to the room screaming, oh, my Hashem erachem. Right away, I put them in the midrashia in Brooklyn. I put them in yeshiva. They became very, very religious. You know, I told you, 1-2 months in yeshiva in Monsi, it's a whole different world. Change your entire hashkafa, your entire anagot, everything. Then they got married. Hashkafa means ideology. Change your entire ideology, the ideology of the Greeks, of the Goyim, and all of a sudden you have ideology of the Torah. By the way, you should know, ideology is one of 4 things that the Jew must have to be righteous. There are 4 conditions to be a righteous person. 1, to keep all the mitzvot of the Torah. You keep the positive mitzvot? Okay. Then you have to stay away from all the averot, from all the restriction. There's 365 restrictions in the Torah. So you don't, you keep all the mitzvot as much as you can. You try. You stay away from all the sins of the Torah. You watch not to eat bad things. You know, everything you watch. No Lashon Hara, you're not breaking Shabbat. Okay. This is two things that everybody understands that without this, it's very hard to be tzaddik, right? If you mechalel Shabbat, how can you be tzaddik? If you eat chazir, how can you be tzaddik? It's a little bit difficult. So you have to, that's everybody know. You ask every secular person on the street, excuse me, what do you need to be religious tzaddik? Right away, it's going to tell you to keep mitzvot and not to make sins. Everybody knows that, even the goyim. They know it. The other two, most people are not aware of. The third thing that you need is to fix your bad traits, your bad midot. You're jealous, you have to get rid of your jealousy. You're lazy, you must get rid of your laziness. You're angry, full of anger, you must get rid of your anger. You're stingy, you must become generous. That's why Hashem put you in this world. You're not a modest person, you are attracted to horrible things, to abomination. You have to work on this to get rid of this bad midot. You eat non-stop, eating, and all your life is food. You gotta get rid of it. You're not a dog, you're a human being. You have to control yourself, you have to have disciplines. So the Torah, it's a school for life. Once you learn a lot of Torah and you learn the mitzvot, and you practice, it makes you a much better human being. You respect your parents in a different level. You help the poor much more generously. You stop lying, you stop fighting with people, you let go, you ma'avir al midotav, you don't fight, you don't take revenge, you become more modest, you watch your eyes, you pray with from your heart, you do a lot of good things. After a few years, nobody can recognize you. So you have to fix your bad midot. Sometimes I see Baalei Tshuva, 20 years Baalei Tshuva. They already have a beard all the way to the belly button. And a very nice, impressive hat. And the tzitziot is almost to the floor. And they learn a lot. And after 20 years, they are the same exact people that they were before they became religious. Same liars. Same thieves in a business, same angry people, same selfish people, same, everything the same. Because nobody taught them that tikkun amidot, that's the purpose of life. Fixing your bad traits, this is the main reason why Hashem put you here. Once your midot is perfect and everything else about you is perfect, Hashem takes you from the world. You don't have to be here anymore. To be in this world, you are in a test. It's like being in a school. Soon you're going to have the final test. You score good, you don't have to go again to school. You fail, you have to come back again to school. You're going to be reincarnated again. You have to come back again in Gilgul. It's never going to end. You have to fix who you are. So that's the third thing. And what is the fourth thing, which is the most important thing out of the four? And almost nobody is aware of it. Almost nobody. What is it? Ashkafa Yehudit. Jewish ideology. In one sentence, I want you to be a kosher Jew and not a Greek. What is the difference between a kosher Jew to a Greek, Antiochus and the rest of them? What is the difference? The Greek live for sport. That's the main thing in his life. Sport. Sport. Where the word sport came from? Sparta. It's a city in Greece. All the competition, boxing, wrestling, fighting, athletic. Where the word athletic come from? It's from the Greeks. Stadium. It's from the Greeks. Everything from the Greeks. This culture, I always wonder, how we celebrate Hanukkah and we're not even aware that we're making ourselves look like fools. Let me clarify. We always say in Hanukkah that we won the Greeks. Hashem wiped out the Greeks. There's no memory of them. The Greeks, by the way, in Greece, are not the descendants of Antiochus. It's a different nation. The Greeks that came to destroy us and our ideology, Hashem wiped them out. That's it. They got mixed in all the nations. Same thing, Paro and the Egyptian. The Egyptians that live in Egypt are regular Arabs. They're not the children of Pharaoh. All the empires are gone. Philistines, gone. Ashur, gone. Aram, gone. Romans, gone. Greeks, gone. The old Persians of Ahasuerus, gone. Babylonians, gone. In Babel, you have Iraqi Arabs. Babylon is gone. All the empires who came after the Jews, Hashem wiped them out. That's a fact. However, when you can say clearly that Hashem wiped out the Babylonians, and he wiped out Pharaoh and his nation, and he wiped out the Romans, can we say the same thing about the Greeks? I'm not so sure. What does it mean? Yes, the Greeks are dead. And there's no more Greek mythology, and it's all history. But until today, 2,500 years later, did we change or we still act like Greeks? Most of us are addicted to sport or no? Come see what happens in yeshivot today. In recess. Just sport, everything, basketball, this, exchanging baseball cards, football cards, all kinds of goyim, admiring all kinds of players. I asked some of the kids, tell me who you admire, Rav Steinemann or LeBron James? You have to see how the kids. Who would you like to meet? I'll take you to Rav Steinemann or I'll take you to... I love Rav Steinemann, I mean, don't get me wrong, but LeBron James? The Greek poison is in every street in Israel. The fact that kids that call themselves religious come and check each other tie for the brand name. Oh, wow. Psh, nice. That shows you that the Greek poison is deeply in every one of us. The fact that people write to me, Rabbi, help me to find shidduch. No problem, send me your shidduch profile. Then I'll know what to say about you. And almost every one of the guys, and sometimes the girls, they write in their shidduch profile about hobbies. You know, there's a section in the shidduch profiles that people write what they like. I like to go on trips and to watch movies. To watch goyish movies. This is a religious person. He wants to marry to a religious girl. One generation ago, if someone would write in his shidduch profile that his hobby is to watch American movies or French movies of goyim with so much lack of modesty and problems, right away you would think he's mentally crazy. It's not normal. What religious person writes in his shidduch profile that he loves to watch American movies of goyim? Today there's no shame. When he writes it in his shidduch profile, it means that it did not even occur to him that something here is wrong. And for that we have to cry. We all have desires to watch movies. We're not saint. We miss the old days. Yes, I know who we are and I'm not living in an illusion. But if I have one day a crave to watch a movie that I used to watch 30 years ago, a minute later I'm ashamed of myself. We have to work a little bit harder to get rid of this Greek poison. The fact that a person does not even think that something in my lifestyle is wrong shows you that he has no chance ever to fix it. Because if you don't know you're sick, you will never be cured. The first step to be cured is to recognize that you're sick. That's why Hashem invented pain. Why, when there's a problem with your tooth, you begin to have pain? Because before it becomes root canal, Hashem wants to save you. And all other pains. So let's clarify what does it mean, Jewish ideology. First, you cannot be a Greek. You have to stay. What does it mean, kdoshim tiyu ki kadosh ani? What does it mean to be holy? What, I make myself a Sefer Torah? What does it mean to be holy? To grow a beard and to close my eyes and to live in a mikveh all day? To make faces when I pray? To wear a jalabiya? What does it mean to be holy? Define what it means, kdoshim tiyu ki kadosh ani. What does it mean? I have to fast every day? I have to roll on the ice? I have to torture myself? I have to walk on nails? I have to be mute for 20 years like the Buddha East and all these people in those places in the East? What does it mean to be holy? The answer to be holy means to be isolated from the nations. Muvdal min ha'amin. You don't dress like them. You don't call your children with their names. You don't sit and eat with them. You don't celebrate their holidays. You don't follow their hobbies. You don't admire their idols. To the point that Rav Hoffman writes in his book, I made a whole series about his book. Maybe it's the best thing I ever did. I gave it to my rabbi, which is a super, super, super genius, huge Talmid Chacham. Somebody like you cannot find another one like this. In every field of the Torah. He told me, I want you to know, I send him the book by gift. I asked my assistant to give him the book. And usually he doesn't read any books because he learns non-stop Gemara, Kabbalah, deep stuff. He doesn't have time for every day there's new books coming out. But he knew if I send him that book, and I don't send him a book once in a few years, it has to be something in it. So he read it. When I came to his house, a few months later, I saw the book on the table. I told him, no, did you like the book? He said to me, I want you to know that this book made a big impact on me. And also I saved already two Talmidim that were totally depressed thanks to the advices on this book. It was already worth it. Rav Hoffman asked a very interesting question. In the Torah, Hashem said to us, we're not allowed to look at the idol worshipping of the Goyim that call Baal Peor. Baal Peor is the most disgusting thing that a human being can do in life. There's nothing more gross than that. The Goyim take their waste and bring it as a gift to some kind of an idol. There's a whole ceremony that they do. Terrible smell. Horrible image. What kind of a normal Jew would be even interested to look at what the Goyim do? So disgusting. The Torah warns us not to look. This is one thing, you're not allowed to be an idol worshiper. We know that. The Rambam writes, two sins make a Jew lose his identity until he does tshuva. If you're a murderer, you're still a Jew. If you're a big thief, you're still a Jew. If you're a horrible human being, you're still a Jew. You can be the worst criminal, you're still a Jew. Two things, the Rambam writes, Harehu kegoy lechol davar, mechalel Shabbat and oved avodah zara. Those are the only two sins that actually make you lose your identity and break the covenant with Hashem. Most Jews understand, I'm not an idol worshiper, come on, Rabbi, I'm going to die and not bow down to an idol. Ya'areg velo ya'avor. So I'm not interested to be an idol worshiper. What's the big deal of looking at these fools sacrificing their waste to their stupid idol? It's education. I want to learn what they do that I can tell my children, look at us and look at them. For a positive reason. The Torah says, don't dare to look at it. Rav Hoffman asks, Hashem has to warn me? What, he's afraid that I'm going to want to be one of them? To go worship the Baal Peor? After I heard the voice of Hashem in Mount Sinai? The answer, Rav Hoffman says something that most people don't know. When you look at the worst thing that you can imagine, that you vomit, you want to vomit, it's so disgusting, it's so terrible, it smells bad, it looks bad, it's horrible. Mamash, literally you vomit, how disgusting it is. The next time you look at it, it will disgust you only 90%. And the next time, only 80%. After 10 times that you look at it, you begin to be comfortable with it. It doesn't bother you anymore. Give it 10 more times, you find yourself doing it with them. How is it possible? Why? Because when you look at something negative, the Torah says, watch your eyes, don't look at bad things. It plants a seed in your subconscious that you are not aware of it now. And the moment will come that that seed will bloom and become a bad poison. And the next thing, you find yourself over there. That's why you're not allowed to look at idols, you're not allowed to look at the face of wicked people. There's a list of things you're not allowed to look at. If you look at a woman that dressed not modest, and after that you do the best tshuva, this image will stay in your soul for eternity. There's no way to erase it. What's the proof for it? When you hypnotize a person, he described to you everything he did and saw in his previous life. Everything in details. When he was in a different body. 80 years ago, before I was born, I was in a different body, my soul. I can describe to you everything I saw. What do you mean? You became religious. Doesn't matter. It stays in the subconscious. I'll give you an example. Do we have to change to Hebrew or we just stay with English? Everyone understands, I guess, right? No. Who does not understand Hebrew? Who does not understand English? That's why you write the whole thing. Very good. We'll stay with English. Let's just stay with English. So. Who does not understand? He speaks Hebrew. No, I just want to make sure that if people do not speak English here and they sit for an hour and a half and waiting, that I'm going to start speaking Hebrew. I don't want to disappoint them. That's why I ask, if everyone understands English, I'll continue with English, because if I turn to Hebrew now, half of you will have to leave. Better to get an extra hour, no?
No, we'll understand.
Very good. It's true, by the way. So now I give you an example how the subconscious works. A woman, an old woman in Bat Yam, in Israel, she stood by a bus stop. ברוך אתה אדוני אלוהינו מלך העולם שהכל נהיה בדברו. And a motorcycle came. Two people were sitting on a motorcycle. One is driving, and the one that sits behind grabbed her necklace, pulled it. He thought it's going to get ripped. Usually when you pull a necklace, it rips. But it was thick gold. When they pulled the necklace, she fell on the floor. It did not rip. So she fell on the floor. People picked her up. Police came. The police asked her, "Did you see the person?" "No." "Did you see the color of the motorcycle?" "No." "I was not looking. It came from behind. The next thing, I fell on the floor. Next thing, I fell on the floor." "You fell on the floor? Okay. Let's take you to the police station. We will hypnotize you. And we'll get out of your subconscious everything you saw." "What do you mean? I didn't see anything." "You saw a lot. You just don't know yet." They took her to the station. The hypnotizer, she told them everything, include the plate number, how the guys looked, everything. The soul sees everything. Everything. But it goes automatically to the subconscious. Right away, the police made an arrest. When you hypnotize a person, thank you. When you hypnotize a person, you can get out of his subconscious things that he saw 800 years ago in one of his reincarnations. One psychiatrist hypnotized his wife for treatment. psychological treatment. In the middle of the treatment, she started to speak in ancient Greek, Egyptian, the language of Pharaoh. She spoke in a language she didn't know, but he was recording the session. They went to all kinds of specialists until somebody knew what she's saying. They are expert to languages. And she said that she's a carpenter who make a special eagle from wood for Pharaoh. Remember, this is his wife. In the middle of hypnosis, she started to describe that she makes an eagle to put on a grave of one of the pharaohs. 9 months later, archaeologists discovered that eagle in Egypt. When they dug over there, they found that eagle. There are hundreds of cases like this. I brought you my CD, Life After Death, in Hebrew and in English. You can see over there famous cases of people that remember their past life or that they made regression and they went back to their previous life. From that, you will learn a lot about all my lectures, not only about reincarnations, about the concept of reward and punishment. About this is the Israeli section? Okay, so we have to go to Hebrew. We will go in a minute. Kansu. Kansu. So, from the concept of hypnosis, you find that people here to fix what they did in their past life. Everything that is difficult for us in this life, that means we failed the test in our past life. We still have a test. Everything that is easy for us now, that means we already fixed. That's why we don't have Yetzer Hara for it. That's why you find two people. One kid is generous, one kid stingy. Doesn't want to give you a penny. Now one pretzel. Why? No, don't touch. The other one, take the whole bag. Why? He was an old man that used to be very generous. And he was a very stingy old man. They both died. They had to come back to life. But because of that, one came back with generosity because he died generous, and one came back with the same problem. People that were not modest, they still have desire to be not modest. People that used to be mechalel Shabbat, it's very difficult for them to keep Shabbat. People that used to play games with tefillin, it's very difficult for them to put tefillin. You don't, it doesn't go by logic here. I'll give you an example. Sometimes, when you ask a Baal Tshuva, Chiloni, that you make him Baal Tshuva, you ask him, which mitzvah is harder for you, to keep Shabbat or to put tefillin? Which mitzvah is harder? Shabbat, it's a lot harder, man. 25 hours, not to smoke, this, that, go to shul. What's tefillin? 2 minutes a day, 5 minutes a day. Big deal. I had one guy. He came to a few of my lectures, became Shomer Shabbat. Tefillin, 6 months every day, I had to call to remind him. 15 minutes, it's Shkia, it's sunset. Did you put tefillin? Not yet. What? Still not? No, it's so hard for me. Shabbat, he lived in a big mansion in Long Island with all lasers, security lasers. Every door he opened, toot, toot, toot. I said to him, this alarm, the alarm. He said, no, it's not in my hand. It's connected to the police. This. I can't touch it. All kinds of lasers that if somebody breaks in, right away the alarm goes off. The entire Shabbat is locked in his living room. He cannot open the door to the pool, nothing. Because every time he opens it, it goes toot, toot, toot. And I said, you sit in the entire Shabbat like this, so boring, and you don't make a beep. Tefillin 2 minutes a day, it's hard for you? Today, I wouldn't ask him that question. Back then, 15 years ago, I didn't have that knowledge. Today, I know it's nothing to do with how difficult the mitzvah is. It depends if you kept it in your past life or not. If you kept it, it's easy. If you didn't keep it, it's very difficult, even if it's a joke. You cannot do it. I would like to say thank you to the English-speaking people. Thank you very much. And now, please, before you leave, maybe we'll do Arvit now, if you don't mind, 10 minutes, we pray Arvit. And, no? Should we do Arvit, right?
Question.
I give 2-3 minutes for question, and then we'll do Arvit, and then we'll go into the Hebrew. Yes, questions, please. I have some books here before you leave in English. Not that many, but you can buy the books. Okay, what's the question?
I heard you say in a lecture that the soul is in the mind.
The soul is in the head, yes. In the brain.
Can you elaborate on that?
The soul is basically revived the entire body. But what is the captain of the boat? The brain. The brain is in charge of the body. The Torah said that if a person died, where his body is, that's become his grave. Today we have cemeteries and everything is organized. But back in time, if a person died in the middle of the desert somewhere, that became his place. You have to bury him over there. The Gemara asks a question, what happened if someone chopped his head off? The body fell to the left and the head fell 10 feet to the right. Where are you going to bury him? Where the body or where the head is? Because the body is 90% and the head is 10%. You have to follow the majority. The Torah says, no, the head is everything. That's where the soul is. So you bury him where the head is, not where the body is. So from here you see that the head is the most important part in a human's body. And of course, from the brain, it functions the entire body, the nerve system, the ligaments, and everything else. Yes? Yes?
You mentioned about, you start speaking on what do you tell a person to make him keep the Shabbat, you know?
Oh, how to evaluate Shabbat.
Yeah.
To evaluate Shabbat. Thank you for reminding me. So I'll tell you something. If a person has a house that worth $100 million, and inside the house he has pictures from Picasso, another $300 million, and in the walls of the house he hid another $500 million. So far we have $1 billion in that house, and his wife lit candles on Shabbat, Friday night. One of the candles fell on an antique Persian rug, and a fire started in the house. Fire! There's no children up there, no life risk. They have time to run out. $1 billion is about to be burned. Is he allowed to put the fire off?
No.
He screams to his neighbor, which is happened to be the rabbi, "Rabbi, give me permission to put the fire off." The rabbi says, "I'm not God. There's no permission to put the fire off." He said to the rabbi, "Rabbi, I donate the house to you and to your yeshiva. Open more shuls, open yeshivot, help the poor, make another 100,000 balei tshuva with his money. Do everything you want. It's your money. Please let me put the fire off. Picasso picture, money, antique Persian rugs, $1 billion home. Let me put the fire off. I'll give you $1 billion. We're going to save 100,000 souls with $1 billion. Do you know how many Baalei Teshuvah I will make with $1 billion? Just allow me to put the fire off. And that's it. I'm not going to anymore break Shabbat. Just to put the fire off. Allowed or not allowed? Not allowed. Now you understand what it means Shabbat or no? Do you understand? One time not to break Shabbat, you have to let $1 billion get burned. Not to break Shabbat one time. One time for $1 billion, it's not allowed. That's the problem. Most people do not understand what Shabbat is. I'll drive to shul with a car. If they understand the severity of the sin, they'll never do it. The problem, it's all about ignorance. People are not aware, and as a result of that, they make big sins. Not because they're bad, or because they want to go against Hashem on purpose. Just they don't have the knowledge. Yes?
If fixing your flaws is one of the main purposes of life, then yeah. All those who say, "Don't change me, I want to be myself, don't try to fix me," this is a wrong approach.
Wrong ideology. What do you mean, "Don't change me"? If you're angry, you have to change. If you're a thief, you have to change. If you're selfish, you have to change. If you don't care about people, you have to change. If you're a bad father, you have to change. There's a lot of bad things about us that we must fix. What does it mean? A person that does, he thinks he's perfect. He thinks he's God. Don't change me. I want to stay the same way I am. But it's against your purpose. The only reason Hashem put you here is to fix yourself, not to stay the same. Any more questions from here? No, nothing here. Go ahead.
Just a follow-up question. How do you know that it is truly a bad habit and it's not just your own delusion, your own bias, so what you should or should not do?
You will never know what's right and wrong until you really learn Torah seriously. Because in our days, many of us, I'll give you an example. A lot of Jews vote Democrat. They don't think that by voting Democrats, it's a sin. But it's a huge sin. Why? Because they promote abortions. It's massive murder. You cannot vote for some, no matter how good they are. They can be very good. But they promote abortions to murder babies. It's against the Torah. You're not allowed to murder babies. If a politician has a lot of good things about him, but one bad thing against Hashem is a mass murderer, it doesn't matter that these Democrats don't understand the severity of their sins. They don't understand. But that's reality. If you vote for them, you give them power to murder a million babies in the next 10 years in the world, in America. You understand? So things like this we're not allowed to support. If someone is promoting gay parades or same-sex marriage, this is Sodom and Gomorrah laws. A religious Jew is not allowed to give his hand to something like that. So I can give you hundreds of examples. This has come from ignorance, from lack of knowledge. Even some modern religious people, they tell them, what? To vote Democrat, it's a sin? Ah, come on. What's the sin here? The sin is that you promote gay parade and gay marriage. And that's exactly what Hashem hates. Or you promote abortions. Or you promote a lot of other things, that it's against the Torah. You understand the idea? So the idea is, if you don't learn what's right or wrong according to the Torah, you will never be able to live according to the Torah. Because ignorance is the biggest enemy of the human being. You can be naturally good. Nobody taught you. You're going to make plenty of mistakes. Ignorance is a killer. Ignorance can cost billions of dollars. In a tax return, the accountant made one mistake, a company lost $2 million because he checked the wrong box. That's it, $2 million they lost that year on taxes because they changed some rules and the accountant was not aware of it. Thank you very much. Okay, I can't say no. Okay, go ahead.
Yeah.
The word punishment is a complicated word because if you really, really analyze the Torah, there's really no such thing punishment. There's reality and consequences. If I put my hand in a fire, I lose my hand. Can I say that God punished me? He created fire. He created my hand. I put my hand in a fire and I lost it. Now I come and say to people, God punished me. He took away my hand. They will think I'm crazy. No, you know, God didn't punish you. You punished yourself. You killed yourself. You killed your hand. So most of the divorce cases, it's because of non-proper behaving. No respect to each other, no patience. And the husband behaved like an animal, and the wife behaved like an animal, and together it's a World War III. Then they get divorced. Usually they regret after that. Why was I like that? I should have behaved better. Most of divorce cases is a matter of bad midot and bad behaving. Some divorce cases is justified. But most of them is just because the people did not want to fix themselves and they pay the price. Same thing raising children, same things in a business, same thing in health, same thing in everything. It's all the consequences of our choices and our action. Thank you very much for the third time. And now we're going to pray Arvit and we continue in Hebrew. Anyone who wants to purchase my book or my USBs is $20. CDs, take as much as you want for free. Thank you. With your permission, I want to say just Kaddish. Just answer. רבי חנניה בן הקשיא אומר, רצה הקדוש ברוך הוא לזכות ישראל. לפיכך הרבה להם תורה ומצוות.